Thank you for the kind introduction. I want to spend a little bit more time on my background because it's relevant to my story. And I want to make very clear that I don't come from a technical background. In fact, I studied psychology and worked as a social worker with pregnant and parenting youth for many years. I then decided to pursue graduate studies in cultural anthropology. I took my love for humans and cultures and translated that into marketing and business development. Then around my 30s, I decided to pursue data science. I studied data science here in Barcelona, then started working as a data scientist, and more recently launched my first venture. Now, if I were to plot these fun facts about myself, you would most likely see something like this, no? So let's imagine on the x-axis, we have Katrina going through life, getting older. On the y-axis, we have Katrina self-actualizing, no, getting closer to some vocational goal. A data scientist would look at this and say, there seems to be no correlation between Katrina getting older and Katrina actualizing. These appear to be kind of random facts. Probably had many existential crises. And the truth is, that was my biggest fear. Every time I changed industry and function, I was worried that I was doing this in vain and that it would never amount to anything. Okay, so what does this have to do with you? I want to do two things. First, it's around storytelling and visibility. Now, when I decided to pursue data science, the first thing I did was go to the student demographics to see if I could find anyone who looked like me. No. Why did I want to do that? Well, first, I was scared shitless to pursue graduate studies in data science. Two, I didn't see many people doing data science at my age. No. So there's something about sharing the stories of people who are on the margins. And this is not unique to women in tech. This, I think, is across the board in female leadership positions. In the VC world, for example, I have this book here. I just recently read Renata George. She's a VC in Silicon Valley, and she just published a book in which she interviewed 100 female VCs. And the point is that this is less than 2% of women are VCs, and she wanted to gain more visibility to encourage others to pursue venture capitalism. The other point, and I'll be very clear with my biases, I believe everyone should pursue technical education. Not only is it really exciting to learn how to program, it's fun if you like puzzles, this is logic, but also it's really powerful to be able to build your own digital products. No? And on a more sort of serious social level, we need more people critiquing technology, because there's a lot of hyperbole out there. And we also need different people from different backgrounds contributing to digital innovation. I like to begin with statistics. And so there's a series of statistics associated with women in technology. I'm pretty sure I've been every one of those statistics. Let's go from the start, right? So I grew up in the most like nerdiest place in the world, Silicon Valley. Every dad I knew was an engineer. When you grow up in Silicon Valley, you develop this radar in which you can determine who's an IT, who's a software engineer, who's a hardware engineer. And I was also the youngest out of six children, which meant that my siblings did not want to play with me. And my grandfather, who was in tech, had pity on me and gave me a computer. I was the first in my family to have a computer, and I loved my computer. I was so cool, I actually digitized my diary at a very young age. I also loved math and science as a little girl. These were my favorite subjects, no? And so despite all of these facts, I was not sent on the path of pursuing computer science, which is strange, no? My story is not unique here, because in fact, little girls perform the same, some statistics will even say, outperform little boys in math and science in elementary school. So then what happened next, right? So then Katrina enters middle school around the age of 11. If you ask Katrina what she wanted to be then, she would have said, I want to be a model. No, sounds good. What does an 11-year-old mean when she says she wants to be a model? She means to say that she wants to be beautiful. No? And where did these values come from? I wanted to be, you know, I love my computer, and then all of a sudden I want to be beautiful. That's my priority. And the point is that these sort of gender stereotypes around values were placed on me. Now, I didn't become a model. and in fact, there's another statistic I want to share with you, that while little girls perform the same as little boys in elementary school, we hear about this leaky pipeline of women in tech, and this is where we have our first big leak. Something happens around girls' early teens, and they drop off the STEM track. And that's exactly what happened to me. What was the result? It was only natural, around 15, that then I would rebel from this all, from Silicon Valley, and say, fuck technology, no? I become a Luddite. I was probably with like a black marker writing fuck technology on buses. I became really against it. And instead, I decided to pursue more meaningful work following a path, sort of the default path, right? So as I mentioned, I went on to do psychology, which was valuable work. No, I don't want to undermine that. It was really important work. I then pursued cultural anthropology, got into marketing. And then something happened around my 30s. Basically, different forces converged. No, so first, in my graduate studies in cultural anthropology, I had a mentor who focused on ecology, right? So this was part of my cultural anthropology studies. And he rekindled my interest in science. He was an engineer by training, and I really got excited about his system of thinking, and I wanted to learn more about that. That's one thing. Another thing happened, and that was that at the age of 30, I started noticing this reoccurring pattern. And that was every time I changed industry and function, I would get bored, and I would feel understimulated and underpaid. And in conjunction with this, I was having sort of tech envy from my friends, who seemed to be like not only being compensated really well and having all this privilege associated with working in tech, but were, you know, intellectually engaged. And I started feeling a sense of loss. So what do I do with that? I started seriously considering, once again, changing industry and function. Now, as soon as I seriously considering that, I call it Doubt City. I was plagued with lots of doubts. No, and they range. What if it doesn't work? What if I waste my money? What if I'm not smart enough? What if, what if, what if, what if, what if? And then my mentor said something to me that I want to share with you because it was really impactful. My mentor, I remember telling him about my idea of potentially pursuing data science. And I remember him smiling. And he said to me, Katrina, at some point, you might consider not listening, not believing to what your mind says about yourself. No? You might decide to mistrust what your mind is saying about yourself. And this gave me pause. And then I started thinking more. I have this group of friends that I respect and admire, and they all seem to think that I can do data science. Surely they can't all be bullshitting me. So I made the executive decision to basically overwrite my self-narrative with the narrative of my friends. And I went for it. I moved to Barcelona. I was closer to the ages of the professors than my peers. They were all my little brothers, and they helped me. They were very supportive. And I went on to pursue data science. There's another statistic that I want to share with you. And that is, most women who enter tech leave tech, right? And there are different reasons for this, and some are really problematic. They have to do with discrimination, they have to do with wage parity, they have to do with hostile environments. And also, though, my bias is that I think as more women get into tech who have different backgrounds, we will see more hybrid professionals. And this really excites me, because I think whenever you're blending in different fields, interesting things emerge. For example, this is Moon Rebus. And she's doing some very interesting stuff with technology and performance art. Moon Rebus is a local here in Barcelona, and she co-founded the Cyborg Foundation. Cyborgs. So she's a performance artist by training, and what she did was have various chips inserted into her body that are synced with the seismic activity around the world, so that in proportion to the intensity of the earthquake, she would feel these vibrations in her body, and she would incorporate that into her performance art. Really cool work. And what she really does is challenge this notion that, you know, technology is not natural, when in fact, you know, it removes us from our environment. In this case, actually, the technology is being used to bring her closer to the environment. Now, not everyone is going to become a cyborg. In fact, 10% of women who are in tech will go on to launch their own ventures. And that is where, that is exactly what happened to me. And so, certainly while working as a data scientist at an e-commerce company, I experienced problems, to which then I needed to problem solve. And one of those was around the alienation I felt as a woman working in tech. So I had this idea in January 2018 to create an all-women coding school. The idea would not leave my mind, and eventually I started punching the numbers and honing in the ideas to formulate something that I could launch. So this is my interpretation of like a labor. I was going to use like a real labor GIF, and then I thought that could be triggering for some, so I decided to use this. I don't know, it made sense. And so CodeOp was born. CodeOp was born just about 1 year ago. And really what CodeOp is trying to do is two things. First, we're trying to encourage more women to get into tech who don't have a technical background. We want to train these women. And then we also want to support companies and organizations to diversify their engineering teams. So right now, you know, we have coding schools around the world, but less than 1% are focused on women. And it's interesting because the issue of the disparity in tech is a worldwide issue, right? So we see that as an opportunity, and that's our mission, is to become this global brand in which we're supporting women entering tech and supporting companies with diversifying their engineering teams. Now, fine, that's an idea. We made the brand, I made the website, launched it. I had no idea what I was doing, and you really don't know what you're doing until you're doing it. So, more problems to solve, and I thought, okay. So, how can I go about this? Well, the first thing that I thought was to apply some of the skills that I had learned in my technical education, and one of those things is about modeling, right? So, when a data scientist wants to build a model, the first thing they do is get something quick out there, get the main elements, and test it. And that's what I did. We launched two products onto the market. One is an 11-week full-stack development program, and this is an entry-level program to get more women into tech. The second product is an advanced course for women who are already working in tech, and this is to support them in their advancement. Now, you guys know that we received a lot of applications, actually over 70 applications from women in over 30 different countries. Not all of those will convert. So the next principle that we had to apply was debugging. And for me, this is really the golden nugget of my technical education. It was super transformative, because when you're studying data science, you're constantly pursuing problems. Problems is the nature of your work. Now, previously, problems were very bad. I didn't want problems. I tried to avoid problems. Problems were points of stress. And so, with data science, it sort of minimizes the issue of problems, and you expect there to be problems. And problems, it's just a matter of debugging. This transferable skill, you can apply. I've applied it to my business. You can apply it to your relationship many times. Sweetie, we need to debug something. And this was really, really powerful. The third concept that I incorporated is parameter tuning. So once you have your model, and you're feeding your model data, you learn more, right? And you need to shift your model. And so you tune your weights. So you have the basic ingredients to your product. And as you collect more data points, then you change the amounts of the ingredients. And that's the parameter tuning. And that's where we're at now. So here we are in our third cohort. These are some of our students in our current full stack development program, looking way too happy for a boot camp. Don't be deceived. They're doing an amazing job, but it's very hard work. And it's been really powerful. This is our third cohort. Our fourth cohort will start in September. We basically have just finished our fundraising round, the first time fundraising, in which we received over $250,000 to pursue our vision, 92% of whom are men supporting our vision. And so I want to return to this life plot, which seemed random. As we add more data points, we start to see something like this. And a data scientist would say, there seems to be a correlation between the two. And my point here is just to, one, encourage you, if anything about this resonates with you, if you have any inkling of pursuing technology or launching your own venture, I really, really encourage you to do it, because a whole new world will open up to you. And so I will now officially step off of my soapbox. Thanks for listening.